Hello. Last time, we set aside the weapons part of the character sheet because we're going to do something slightly different. Well, we will make the name of the weapon clickable and use that to roll the item, just like we did before. Probably should have done that last time. But instead of just sending the partial to the chat log, we'll create a new handlebars template because we'll want to do some custom stuff. First, we are going to include the partial for the weapon, because we still want that, and let's throw in the item description if there is one. Where it gets interesting is that we're going to add buttons that will make do things later. There are two actions I want to be able to do from a weapon card: attack and reload, if the weapon can be reloaded, that is. So we'll create a button for each. I only want the owner to be able to use those buttons, but if you remember the last video, I mentioned that the content of the messages in the chat log is saved. This means we have to put everything that may be displayed in the template and then hide stuff accordingly. The other key bit is writing down the ID of the weapon and of its owners, as we'll need them to retrieve the relevant data. To hook up these buttons, we need to do something new, sort of. In the system's main JavaScript file, we hooked onto the init event to initialize our system. This time, we'll hook onto another event called RenderChatLog. We want this to be called whenever the chat log is rendered, so we'll use hooks.on rather than hooks.once. Instead of calling an anonymous function on the spot, we'll create a separate one, just for organization purposes. The hook gives us three arguments: the chat log application, the HTML content, and some data object. We only care about the HTML here, so we'll filter the rest out. We're going to call our function addChatListeners, which we'll leave in a file called chat.js, and import as a chat namespace, just like we did for dice rolling functions in the last video. Inside this function, we're back into familiar territory, adding new listeners, except this time we don't have to do the binding of the this keyword, since we're not inside a class. We'll start with the reload check, as it's the simplest one. As mentioned earlier, we need to retrieve the weapon's owner using game.actors.get, passing the owner ID. We can then get the weapon itself from the list of owned items. Now we can call the dice.reloadCheck function, which doesn't exist yet, but we know we'll need to pass the weapon. This reloadCheck function is very similar to the defCheck function we wrote last time, so much so that I could probably refactor them into one. Another day. Essentially, this is creating a message from a dice roll with a custom template. The template isn't doing anything fancy, we're just adding some text to make it explicit whether the check was successful or not. We have now created our first interactive chat message. Depending on your system, the attack roll could be just as simple, but not here. In Feng Shui, you only roll for attack, not for damage. The damage is determined by the margin of success of the attack and the toughness of the opponent. Since I don't want to fully automate the attack process, I'm splitting this into two steps, which are going to be handled by two different messages in two different ways. Clicking on the attack button on the weapon card is going to trigger the first step, which is making the attack roll. Hooking up the button is going to be the same as for the reload check, except that we'll be calling a function called attack, taking three parameters: the attacker, the weapon, and whether the attack is using a fortune point. Over in the attack function, we need to do some prep. As usual, we'll be using a custom template for the message we'll end up sending. Attack roll are simply task checks, but the action value depends on the weapon. Melee weapons will use martial arts, guns, spells, sorcery, etc. If you remember part 1 of the series, we stored that info in the weapon data. However, the character might not have the relevant stat for a given weapon. In the entity class for our actors, we'll create a new function that will return the value of the stat with the given name if the character has it, and null if not. If the character can't use the weapon, we can use the UI.notifications.error function to send an error notice at the top of the Foundry window. Otherwise, we'll use the return value as the action value for the task check. But first, we need to make some modification to the task check function. In Feng Shui, you can, in certain conditions, attack multiple characters with a single attack roll. When you do, you get an attack penalty equal to the number of targets. I could alter the action value to reflect that, but I would prefer this penalty to be visible in the roll formula. Therefore, I'll add a penalty setting to the task check function, which will default to 0. This will be appended to the roll formula and roll data if there is anything to deduct. To get the number of targets, we can actually use Foundry's targeting system. The other change we need to make to the task check function is to make the sending of the message optional. In order to do part 2 of the attack sequence, the message containing the attack roll result needs to contain a way to retrieve the weapon, or at least get its damage value. The problem is that you can't pass custom data to roll.render. So we need to render the roll separately and inject it into another template. To that effect, we'll add another setting to task check called sendMessage, which will default to true. If it's true, we send the message as we did before. Otherwise, we return the roll result. This way, we can grab it in the attack function, render it, and pass the resulting HTML as data to our main attack roll message template, which we'll create in the same way we did for rolling items. However, since we're not using roll.toMessage, we need to specify in the message data that this is indeed a roll, and that we should play the corresponding sound. If we don't do that, modules like DiceSoNice will not work on this message. A few things to note on the attack roll template. As discussed earlier, we're also storing the damage value of the weapon in an easy-to-access data attribute. Also, you can have variables in localizable strings, which you'll define in curly brackets in the language packs, and refer by name in the helper function. Finally, if one of the variables in your HBS context is HTML content, like our rendered role, you can have handlebars outputted verbatim using triple brackets instead of the usual double. Okay, now we have a functional attack button. Let's add some characters to our scene and check that attacking multiple targets does work. Great! Now for the second part, responding to the attack by defending or dodging. When you create a message as anything other than a public role, you can right-click on it and turn it into a public message. Did you know that you can add items to this context menu? To do so, we have to hook onto another event called GetChatLogEntryContext. We'll point to a yet uncreated function from the chat namespace that we'll call addChatMessageContextOptions. This function takes two arguments, the HTML content of the message and the current list of context menu options. What we're going to do in this function is simply add to the options array by calling the push function on it, to which we pass a series of objects defining a context menu option. These objects are defined in the exact same way as the context menu options we added to the character sheet in part 2. We'll define the callback in a moment, but it's going to be called defend, taking the message as a parameter. This time, however, we want to specify a condition to be met for the message to appear. This condition has to be a function, because the hook we're in is only called once during the creation of the chatlog application. However, we'll put this function in a variable for readability and convenience. What we're checking here is that the user has selected a token, and that the message we've right-clicked on is an attack role, by looking for specific selectors in its HTML. Okay, now let's look at this defend function. Most of it is going to be system-specific, so you can skip to the next section of the video if you're in a hurry. First, we need to retrieve some info from the chat message, namely the weapon damage and the result of the attack roll. I recommend wrapping those in a parseInt function if you don't want to deal with JavaScript's nonsensical handling of strings and numbers. We'll also retrieve the list of selected actors, as we assume that these are the ones defending against the attack. I'm using the slice function to make a copy of the array, as we're going to modify it. In Feng Shui, when you attack several characters at once, you make a single attack roll against the target with the highest defense. But defense is affected by impairment, so we need to calculate that. The best place for it is in the actor's prepare data. I'll create a property called effective defense, which is going to be the defense minus the impairment. It's not great to have it not grouped with the base defense value, though. That's an argument for storing stats as objects, like D&D 5e does. But I will live with it for now. It gives me a reason to make a video about data migration. Back to our defend function. We can now sort our list of defenders in decreasing order of effective defense value, after which we'll pick the first one as our main defender. We'll also grab its defense value and store it in a variable. You may have noted that the defend function has an optional dodge parameter. In this system, dodging just means you get +3 on your defense, while the rest of the attack process is the same. The outcome of the attack is going to be the result of the previous roll minus the top defender's defense. If the outcome is negative, it means the attack didn't land, so we'll send a message saying who blocked the attack. Note that this time I'm not using chatmessage.getSpeaker, as messages of these kinds are never in character. Instead, I'm passing the user to get their name as the speaker. There's nothing special about the template. I could have done that directly in JavaScript, but this way the template is already set up if I ever want to do something more elaborate. If the outcome of the attack is greater than or equal to zero, the attack landed, so we have to work out how much damage has been dealt, if any. This starts with the smackdown, which is the sum of the outcome and the weapon's damage value. Players might need to know the smackdown value, so we'll need to set that aside to display it in the resulting message. While multiple targets share a defense value, actual damage calculation is done per character, so we will iterate through our defenders. We're going to send one message per defender, so let's prepare the data for the template. This ApplySmackdown function is the one that's going to take care of calculating the actual damage sustained by the character, as well as updating the wound points. Again, this is very specific to this system, so I'll only explain the bare minimum. The one thing you need to remember here is this call to the actor's update function, changing the value of the actor's wound point by specifying which field to update and what the new value is. You can now skip to the next chapter unless you want context for the message template we'll look at in a bit. ApplySmackdown is returning three pieces of information: how much damage was sustained, whether the character is downed, and whether they require a check to stay in the fight, something heavily damaged heroes and bosses need to do. Mooks fall as soon as they're hit, so we have no calculation to make here. For other character types, we need to calculate damage sustained and clamp that so that it doesn't exceed our maximum. Only featured foes and supporting characters fall when reaching their maximum number of wounds. And as mentioned earlier, bosses and heroes need to make a check whenever they take smackdown while over a certain wound point threshold. Finally, we actually apply the damage before returning the object with the information our message needs. By default, chat messages are public, but the GM might not want to broadcast info about how much damage NPCs have sustained. So let's restrict the message's visibility. This is done by specifying whisper targets. This field will want a list of users. In this case, the targets are all the users who have ownership of the actor. I'm using the hasPerm function to filter through the array of users. Note that game masters always have ownership of actors. Now, let's try this out, looking at both the game master and player views. As you can see, player 1 can only see CJ's damage report, as she's the only actor they can control. I've also preset the damage value for the various characters, so that we can see all the possible messages we can get out of this template. There is obviously a lot of room for improvement on the attack summary template, but I'll have a think about that in my own time. I'm not going to show how to hook up the upcheck button, as it's no different from the other buttons we set up earlier in the video. That will be your homework. If I were to reveal the attack report for Demon Joe Jang to everyone, then player 1 would have access to the upcheck button. Remember that the content of the message is the same for everyone, but we don't want people to see buttons they shouldn't press. But we can do something about that. There's a hook called RenderChatMessage that, as the name suggests, allows us to make some alterations to the way chat messages are rendered. We will end up doing multiple things in this hook, but in this video we'll stick to hiding irrelevant button using a hideChatActionButtons function we're about to create in our chat.js file. In there, we're going to search the message's HTML for a selector that identifies the type of messages we're interested in. Here, .fs2e.chatCard, which are classes that have been defined at the root of our attack report template. If we find those selectors, we can retrieve the actor using the ID we conveniently stored in a data attribute. And assuming that actor exists, we're checking if the current user is the owner of the actor. If that is not the case, then we're going to look for a selector identifying the buttons we want to hide, and for each of them, set their display to none. Now, in player 1's view, I can see the upcheck button for my character, but not for the boss. And with that, we've looked at the vast majority of ways to customize chat messages. We still need to deal with crits and fumbles, but I'll tackle these next time. Bye!